Imagine the old days come out to spotting it. You wouldn't know what's coming in and out. You really need a binocular just to look around. Time has changed. That is the jackpot of plane spotting. I'm standing in the cold and doing this because I love doing this.
Sam, did you get a good shot?
Oh, not bad, not bad. You were tracking the flight, right? Where did that flight go to?
To Newark.
Newark? Ah, it's a bit windy right now. What's the wind doing, do you know?
Let me check on the radar box.
Do they have an ATIS on the radar box?
Yes, let me check. 33015 knots.
Ah, no wonder I can hear the wind.
I've been tracking flights for years. I know a few things that can help you spotting. Come with me. Sam, what do you think this is?
This has to be that radar box, right? This is a box.
Correct, this is a radar box receiver. All you need is an antenna, a connection to the antenna, a power supply, and a connection to the internet. And it processes flight data and sends the data to our servers.
But can you walk through the whole process? Because I still don't understand.
Yes, I'll explain that to you, Sam. So we have an aircraft, and the aircraft needs to have a MODES transponder. So the transponder is an equipment in the aircraft that sends real-time data. Then that data is received by one of our antennas, and the antenna sends data to the receiver. The receiver processes the data, works the data, and sends relevant data to our servers. Simultaneously, our servers get data from 24,000 boxes, that's the number of radar boxes that we have nowadays. They process the data and get the data ready for the final customer.
Why would people share data with you through this box? They have to connect to internet and power. Why would people bother with sharing data?
Aviation is driven by passion and the feeling of someone in a remote place, in a remote location of this planet, of sharing data with us and being part of one of the biggest aviation communities worldwide.
Hi there, my name is Leander and I live on the east coast of Canada in Newfoundland and Labrador. We are 100 miles inland from the Atlantic Ocean next to CYYR. I really enjoy this because I can track 10 to 15 planes an hour within a 400 kilometer radius of my house.
Sam, you know what's this?
It looks like a map with handwritten stuff on it. Wait, is that like you manually track this? You handwritten on it?
Correct. At that time, there was no internet, no flight tracking software, and I had written here all the planes over the Atlantic Ocean by hand. I wrote the location of the planes, so this is manual flight tracking.
Wow, I can't believe somebody did that. Like, without computer, without internet.
So this is how it started. I have a passion for aviation, and I went to the airport many times to spot this beautiful TWA 747. In 1987, I got my first handheld radio, and I could listen to communications between air traffic controllers and pilots with this radio. Actually, I follow you on Instagram, and we tracked your flight from your solo flight from Torrance to San Bernardino. The aircraft is ADS-B equipped, and you flew at 7,500 feet. Actually, we also tracked your flight back to Torrance.
Oh wow, that's incredible! You can even track my flight and showing the VFR chart, like all the airspace here, colorful, huh? Do you guys know what's the world's biggest aircraft? And I'll give you a hint, it is not the Antonov 225. There's something even bigger, and I want to see how you track this airplane.
Yeah, it's a strato launch. Just like you, Sam, I also love aviation. And it seems that this plane, six engine plane, did lots of flight testing on April 29th in the Mojave at 10,000 feet.
What I'm interested is right now, I want to know how many planes are flying in the sky every day. You know, because the numbers must be down a lot since COVID. Are we on that recovery path?
Looking at Radarbox statistics, it seems that we are finally having good aviation news. Nowadays, we see an average of 70,000 commercial flights worldwide. That's a much higher number than the 22,000 that we saw last year, but a little bit shy away of the 100,000 that we see on a pre-COVID year. On the left, you can see traffic for 2020, on the right, 2021. And it looks like that the US is leading the way, followed by Europe on aviation recovery. And we can see here Asia, the Middle East, Australia, and it seems that every region is slowly recovering, having more flights than last year.
Is there a way on the AirNav Radarbox here to just show only cargo flights? Because I knew there's a lot of cargo out of 70,000.
Yes, of course, Sam. You just go to our website. On the filter settings, you deselect airliner and you select cargo.
So, Sam, I'm going to show you one of the typical messages that we receive out of the 2.5 billion that we receive daily.
Okay, so here's a typical message that we receive. So, for example, you have the aircraft, you have the aircraft type, you have the MODES hex code, you have the call sign, the flight number. Later here, you have the position, the latitude and longitude, and the altitude also, the heading, the ground speed, the squawk code.
But you don't obviously look at all these 2.5 billion by manually, right?
Yeah, actually, sometimes we do have to look at those messages manually, because sometimes the errors are caused by decoding errors and like signal errors. Even the MODES hex code can come wrong, which would make the aircraft being mistaken by a different aircraft.
Because I've seen on flight tracking app, the common error is the aircraft registration belongs to an A380. And they said this is a Cirrus 22. It's really weird.
Yeah, we have to fix it on the back end so that we, when we process the data, we can detect those errors, do some validation on our side, and be able to eliminate those.
The Radarbox is created by aviators for aviators. And we have some unique features which we find them to be very interesting. For example, this is a newly delivered Emirates A380, which did the fully vaccinated flight. It has premium economy. We have this unique feature, aircraft utilization, which clearly shows that this aircraft has made 227 flights since delivery and is flying an average of 13.2 hours per day.
That's pretty high. I think Emirates is pleased with this airplane.
So our airport page, in this case, we are showing London Heathrow. We can see that in Heathrow, they are now with a single runway operation and they are using 09 right for bus takeoff and landing. This is the airport heat map where we can see the most flown destinations from London Heathrow. We can see that New York Kennedy is on top, followed by Doha in Qatar. Another unique feature that we have is real-time airband radio. In this case, we are listening to Anchorage 118.3 frequency, tower frequency, so we can track the planes and listen to them in real time.
So who use your data here?
Our data is used by all types of aviation-related customers, from aviation enthusiasts to airports, airlines, business jet operators. For example, we have Cancun Airport that compiles takeoff and landing data using our data sources. And we even have NASDAQ. They predict stock prices using flight tracking data.
Ah, so I've seen now on the screen, like this one I chose, EVA Air 777. And this one is tracked by satellite, right? There's a little satellite symbol here.
So we have 13 different data sources, and at any time we select which is the best data source to track a flight. In case of this EVA Air 777 from Taipei to Los Angeles, it's being tracked by satellite because it's the most relevant data source.
But what's your preference of the tracking?
Ground-based ADS-B data is by far the most reliable and with faster update speed. So if we have ground-based ADS-B, we always prefer to use ground-based ADS-B.
Andre, that was great. You've seen a lot today and playing with the radar box filter and see all the flights around the world. I can do this for hours at home. But what sort of feature you guys would like to see that is currently not developed or available on a flight tracking app? I would like to hear from you. Leave it in the comment section.